Good morning, Calvary. Let's all stand. Let's put our hands together. Woo! God, we are so excited to worship you this morning, and this is our prayer. Worshiping the name of our God, we will declare your greatness. Lord, we thank you so much for the opportunity to worship you this morning, and it's in your name we pray. Amen. You may be seated.
Amen. Good morning, church. How are you guys? If you're happy to be here, give God some glory. Come on. Good. Hey, we have a super, super special morning. We have baptisms happening in the house. Come on. It's going to be a super, super special service. So, hey, as people are still getting sad and everything, just a couple of announcements. One, we are looking for some folks to step forward for Spanish translation. We have at both campuses a need for the ability to offer service in Spanish. And so we've got Spanish speakers that attend, and we want them to be able to hear the message in their own language. We've got studios, kind of a little sound booth area, where we translate live into folks that need that assistance. And so if you are fluent, would you please give us a call at the office. We'd love to get you plugged in. Even if it's just one service a month, it would be a huge, huge blessing. So pray about that and please step forward. Second, we have a VBS happening. As we kind of told you guys last week, we're scrambling a little bit because our kids' summer camp was canceled due to staffing issues on the camp that we were going with from Colorado. And so we are putting on our very own VBS in-house, and it's going to be awesome. And so Donna and Pastor Will have been spearheading that. And so signups are now live, I believe, for that. And it's only $20 a kid. So it is very affordable, and it's going to be for half day in June. So make sure you get your kiddos signed up for that. Now, before I have you stand, I do want to say we are having baptisms. They'll be after Mark's message, which gives you time. If you have never been baptized, this is the service that we want to make available to you. If you are a believing adult and you've never taken that step in baptism, today's the day. So you can step up. We've got smocks and, you know, scrubs for you that you can get baptized in. You didn't pack anything. You weren't prepared. We're prepared for you. And so if you've been praying about it and you forgot that it was today, just head out of service during the worship and we'll get you checked in over there and we'll get you everything that you need to have. And we'd love to celebrate that with you. And there's, I think, 16 people getting baptized today already. So it's going to be amazing. So hey, listen, if you're new, make sure on your way out, if this is your first time at Calvary, check in with our Guest Connect counter. They are right through these doors over to the right of the atrium area with the Connect area hub there. We'd love to give you a gift and just get to know you, hear your story real quick before we send you on your way. So let's stand together. Say hi to someone around you and let's continue to worship the Lord.
Savior say, thy strength indeed is small. Child of weakness, watch and pray. Find in me thine all in all. As Jesus paid it all to him I owe. Sin had left a crimson stain, he washed it white as snow. Amen. White as snow. It's only by his power. Lord, now indeed I find thy power. And that alone can change the leper's spots and melt the heart of stone. 'Cause my Jesus paid it all to him I owe. My sin had left the crimson stain, he washed it white as snow. Before the throne I stand in him complete. Jesus died my soul to save. My lips shall still repeat.
Lift our voices.
'Cause Jesus paid it all to him I owe. Sin had left a crimson stain, he washed it white as snow. My sin had left a crimson stain, he washed it white as snow. He washed it white as snow. He washed it white as snow. Sing, oh, praise the one. And oh, praise the one who paid my debt and raised this life up from the dead. Oh, praise the one who paid my debt and raised this life up from these words. Jesus paid it all to him I owe.
Sing it out.
My sin had left a crimson stain. He washed it white as snow.
Amen. Let's give him praise.
Let's pray. Lord, we are so grateful that we are here and we are on this Lord's Day remembering that you rose from the dead, and because you are alive, we are alive, and we have eternal life, a life that never ends. Thank you for forgiving our sins. Lord, we're excited today for those who are giving their public affirmation of their faith in your son, Jesus. We ask super blessing on them, on their families and friends who are here as well, that you'll open the word to us. Bless us, Lord, whether we're here or we're at home or wherever we might be watching and taking in this service. In Jesus' name, and everybody said, amen. Please be seated. How are you guys? Great. It's great to see you and to be back. I want us to open our Bibles to the book of Acts chapter 14. You know, we're doing it verse by verse through the book of Acts. And I didn't want to leave the section where I left off week before last without pulling something out that I felt really spoke to me, and I wanted to share it with you guys. And Acts chapter 14, verse 8. If you don't have a Bible, you can look on with somebody. We're always happy to share a look on our Bible, looking with you at our scripture. Chapter 14, verse 8. Now at Lystra, there was a man sitting who could not use his feet. He was crippled from birth and had never walked. He listened to Paul speaking. And Paul, looking intently at him and seeing that he had faith, made him to be made well, said in a loud voice, "Stand upright on your feet." And he sprang up and began walking. And when the crowd saw what Paul had done, they lifted up their voices, saying in Lyconian, "The gods have come down to us in the likeness of men." Barnabas they called Zeus, and Paul Hermes, because he was the chief speaker. And the priest of Zeus, whose temple was at the entrance of the city, brought oxen and garlands to the gates and wanted to offer sacrifices with the crowds. But when the apostles, Barnabas and Paul, heard of it, they tore their garments and rushed down to the crowd crying, "Men, why are you doing these things? We also are men of like nature as you, and we bring you good news, gospel, that you should turn from these vain things, another translation, worthless things, to a living God who made the heaven and the earth and the sea and all that is in them. In past generations, he allowed all the nations to walk in their own ways. Yet he did not leave himself without witness. He's pointing to the revelation of God in nature. And I don't think this is his whole sermon either, but he says, he did not leave himself without witness, for he did good by giving you rains from heaven and fruitful seasons, satisfying your hearts with food and gladness. Even though you didn't know him, he's still being good to you. And even with these words, they scarcely restrained the people from offering sacrifice to them. The gods have come down to us in the likeness of men. What's going on here? Well, if you're Greek, you would understand what was going on. Or if you were Roman, you'd understand what was going on. And the backstory, maybe some of you remember, but you understand this better when you know the backstory. And the backstory was that Paul and Barnabas found themselves in the middle of a myth. You see, Greek mythology, in the stories of Greek mythology, they tell about Zeus and Hermes, these two gods, Zeus, the chief god, and Hermes, who was like the god who communicated, they visited Lystra, this town. And they came one time. When they came, they were looking for somebody to show them some kind of hospitality, but nobody does. The actual story says that the people shut their door in their faces. They found no hospitality except for one couple who lived outside the city. And this old couple offered them a place to stay, and they took care of their needs. And they told the gods, we would like one favor, two favors. Give us two favors. And it sounds kind of like Aladdin with his lamp, you know. Two favors. One was that we would be able to be the caretaker of your temple here, the Zeus's temple. And two, that when we die, we would die at the same time so that one of us would not have to grieve for the other alone. And so their wish was granted. They became the caretakers of Zeus's temple, and they became, when they died, they died at the same time. And later, as another honor for them, Zeus raised them up and made each one of them two stately, beautiful trees and planted them on either side of the doors going into his temple. This is the story. Now, as a punishment to the city for not showing them hospitality, as a punishment for their lack of kindness toward them, Zeus destroyed everyone in the city. He destroyed the city, and that was that. So now these citizens remember, oh, my great-great-great-grandpa told us about the time when our city was destroyed by Zeus and Hermes when they showed up and nobody was hospitable to them, so it's not going to happen again. This is our second chance. Because Paul and Barnabas had brought such attention by healing this man that everybody knew was crippled from birth. Everybody heard about it, got the excitement up, and they saw Barnabas, who must have been more the stately, tall, probably good-looking guy, and Paul was short, and we already described Paul one time, but he was the talker. And so they said, this must be Zeus, and this is Hermes. And out of excitement, they began to talk to one another in the Lyconian language. And they began to, the priest of Zeus ran out and he began to prepare oxen for sacrifice, decorating them with these flower garlands. Now, they were giving their best. If you gave an ox in those days, you were giving your livelihood. Because you needed an ox to plow fields to get your food so that you could live. They were offering their best. And Paul and Barnabas realized what was happening, and they were horrified. People ask, well, why didn't they know what was going on beforehand? Why didn't they see it? Well, when Paul and Barnabas first got there, the people were speaking to them in Latin. Latin was the common language that the Lycaonians would speak. You know, it was the language of commerce and all. But when they got so excited, they began to speak in Lycaonian. And that language, Paul and Barnabas didn't understand. Note this, Paul and Barnabas spoke Latin, Greek, Hebrew, and Aramaic. Four languages. They could understand them. They could read them. They could write them. So they didn't know what was going on until they saw the crowd and became obvious what was being done. As Jews, of course, you never worship any person nor any idol or an image of any so-called God. They ripped their clothing, showing separation. When you rip your clothes, you're showing, I'm separating this from the other. In other words, they're saying, we are not having any part with what is going on right here. And so Paul preaches a message. They didn't have scripture. There was no synagogue there. Maybe there are a couple Jews, Timothy and his grandma and grandpa, mom and grandmother. I don't know if there are any others. But there was certainly no witness of the scriptures among those inhabitants. So Paul had to appeal to nature and the things around them, and he was building an argument for the one true living God based upon that. He's saying, you have everything you believe in, all that you understand the world to be, the sea, the land, the air, it's all been created by one God. And this is the God who we've come to talk to you about. But even though they were bringing the gospel to them, it says they were scared. They almost weren't able to stop these people from offering sacrifices to them. Something that I was wanting to point out here was that the people had such a wrong view of God. They thought gods were like people. The Greek gods and Roman gods were terrible. If you haven't studied mythology much, you have to understand that these gods, yes, they would come in human form, but when they did come in human form, they caused a whole lot of trouble on earth. Even when they weren't in earth, when they were in their own realm, their lives were immoral. They'd come down to earth and they would take one god's wife from another and they would fight till the death. And some of the god Pan molested people. And you had other gods who would trick people. None of them could be trusted. What they would do is they would just offer sacrifices and hope that that was enough to appease these harsh gods. And so that gods came in the form of men wasn't too hard for them to believe, but they thought the gods acted like people. Whenever you look at the gods in the pagan world, about as far back as I can think, they're all in the image of some person. People make gods like themselves. And you know, I know it goes without saying that a lot of progress has been made in the last more than 2,000 years, of course, but some things haven't changed, and it's that people still make gods like themselves. People still believe myths about God. And I'd like to challenge two of those myths. One of them is the Greek idea was that you just couldn't trust God. The gods, you just couldn't believe them. You couldn't take them at their word. Well, the true and the living God can be trusted, unlike the gods of the ancient world. But maybe we think sometimes, well, if I were God, I wouldn't have let this happen. You know, if God is a good God, then why? How many have heard this? Or leave your hand up, we thought it. Come on, we are honest here. We can be, why not? Right? We've thought, we've wondered, well, God, if you're a good God, I can't understand why that child died or why this accident happened or they were so young or you allowed a terrorist to take out thousands of people. I don't understand. Okay. Your God, the living true God, is not a person like you. You are not going to understand everything that God does or God allows. Even when we get to heaven, we talk about in heaven, things will be made clear. Let me just say, some things will be made clear. I'm not sure we'll ever understand everything about God or he wouldn't be God. Amen? So when God seems to disappoint you, and I believe these people for sure were very disappointed that Paul and Barnabas, I mean, weren't gods. I mean, they just didn't want to believe it. It took everything they Paul and Barnabas could do to stop them from sacrificing to them. It sometimes our ideas about God are hard to shake. I want us to get a real view of. First of all, that God can be trusted. The one true living God can be trusted, even though he doesn't think like we do. Look at Isaiah chapter 55. Go to the left in your, toward, it's in the Old Testament. As you go left, you're going to go, you'll Daniel, Ezekiel, Jeremiah. There's Isaiah. Look at chapter 55. I know some of you use devices. You have your Bible on, you know, some kind of a device. That's great. But figure out how to make notes, because I want you to note the passage that we're going to read here. It's Isaiah 55. And those of you have the book in hand, I want you to look at verses 8 and 9, and I want you to be ready to mark those so you can find it again. God says, "For my thoughts are not your thoughts, neither are your ways my ways," declares the Lord. "For as high as the heavens are above the earth, so are my ways higher than your ways and my thoughts than your thoughts." My thoughts, my ways. I notice that in each verse he says that, my thoughts, my ways, my thoughts. He's emphasizing the way I think and what I do is different than the way you think and what you would do. Do we all understand that? We can't make God like us. Well, is he good? Is he loving? Let's just don't go there yet. Let's just establish the fact that God doesn't operate always like we would. Are you okay with that? Okay, he's different because he's God. Now, is he good and all of those things? Yes. We're not going to look at all of that today. I just want to say that God is trustworthy no matter what he does. Golly, you know what happened to me? We went to Vancouver to visit our son and daughter and our two sweet little grands. And we had a beautiful time. I mean, Vancouver, Washington is just like everything's in bloom. The azaleas, the rhododendrons, the dogwood trees. I mean, it was like, oh, are you kidding me? It's like an advertisement to get people to live there. You know what I'm saying? Rainforest, all that. So we come home to Arizona. It is so brown. I told Leslie, I'm glad we're coming home in the evening. At night, because it would be a terrible contrast to land in bleak. It was so restful up there. The green was just so restful. So we went up there and came back. We were at Sky Harbor Airport Terminal 3, and they have these very steep escalators. And we were on the going up escalator, okay? So we're going up, and the big heavy suitcase in front of me on the step before me started to, I'm going to say, lose its balance. It became in balance, and it fell on me. It started to fall on Leslie, too. Somehow she was able to hold it over there, but it knocked me down, and I went backwards down the up escalator about 12 steps. Yeah, ooh. I mean, and you can't get up because you're trying to get up, but the stairs moving up behind you. You know what I said? You laugh. Yeah, you think it's funny, huh? Second row, second person. And I'm telling you, this is a nightmare. It really is a bad. I hit my head. I hit my spine. My arm. I have track marks scratched into me. I got track marks here. I'm all bruised here, and I was bleeding. And then there was a guy, by the time I got to the 12th or 13th step, and I can't get up because you can't get a grip on the plexiglass wall because it's moving. And I thought, I have no idea where I'm going to end. And this guy behind me says, do you need help up? Which was like the dumbest question in the world. Do I need help up? No, so he helped me up, but he pulled me so hard that I've got a big bruise from his hand. I mean, really, it looks like a hand picked me up. And then I sprained my wrist when I fell. Yeah, I know. I wouldn't have done that. If I were God, I wouldn't have done that. Did it shake my trust in God? No. No. It has made me wiser. I always take the elevator. Always, you guys, take the elevator. Didn't shake my, you know, I don't know what was in all that. Oh! And then I'm bruised, and Leslie's trying to take care of me, and we're going, I'm bleeding, and I mean, the paramedics were no help. They didn't have a Band-Aid. Did you know that? No Band-Aid. So they wrap gauze around all this, and so I'm like, oh, and we go, and we get the van, the tire's flat. I know. Okay, so that's the story of woe. I wouldn't have planned it that way. But for some reason, God in his thoughts and in his way, God allowed that to happen. Did it shake my confidence? No. Why? Because I trust him. You know, one reason we trust him is because we've seen him work in the past, and we have had the advantage of hindsight many times with the work of God in our lives, right? So if we can trust him for things that we have known, we can trust him still with things that we don't understand now. My thoughts. God is not like those gods who would lie to people. The Bible says God is not a man. God is not a man, a human that changes his mind all the time. He does not lie. God is not like us. He can always be trusted. He always does right. He always does right. The other thing that we often think, and there's nothing wrong with thinking these ways when I'm saying this, it's like, why do you think this? But people will think, well, if God is just, then why? Usually goes to a Hitler. If God is just, then why Hitler? Why? Well, listen to this. The evil people of all the, you know, going back as far as we can we know. The Neros, the Hitlers, you know, all of these horrible Idi Amins, you know, the terrorists. Well, if God is just, wait a second. God is just. It's just that people don't get the justice of God before they die, usually. They die and they haven't experienced God's justice yet. The Bible tells us that even after they die, it's going to be a while before they experience God's justice. But they will. And I want you to just look at Revelation chapter 20. It's the last book of the Bible, chapter 20. This time is called the second resurrection. This is when the wicked people are raised to life and they're going to stand before the great white throne of God, which is God's justice throne, and God is going to mete out what they deserve. Look at what it says. Then I saw a great white throne and him who was seated on it. From his presence, earth and sky fled away, and no place was found for them. And I saw the dead, great and small. These are the wicked dead, as you'll see. I saw the dead, great and small, standing before the throne. These are really bad guys, great and not so bad guys, but they haven't trusted God. They're not saved. Great and small, standing before the throne. And the books were open. And then another book was opened, which is the book of life. And the dead were judged by what was written in the books according to what? What they had done. Believe me, the History Channel does not know everything Hitler did. What is it about the History Channel? It seems like all there are documentaries about Hitler. I don't know. Nobody knows all the wicked and the evil thing that he and other people have done, but you know what? Every single thing God knows, that's what this is telling us. And they will have to give account for all according to what they had done. And the sea gave up the dead who were in it. Death and hell gave up the dead who were in them. And they were judged, each one of them, according to what they had done. See, we're saved by grace. Amen? You are not going to be in this judgment. Somebody say amen.
Amen.
No, we're not even close to this, okay? The closest thing we get is when we stand before Jesus is called the judgment seat of Christ. The word judgment seat means a raised platform like I'm on right now. It's the word bima, to be lifted up. And on a raised platform, the judges of the Olympic Games would sit and watch the games, and the winners would come and they would be given their rewards, okay? So someday, the Bible says, all of us believers will appear before the judgment seat of Christ. It's not a judgment for salvation. It's a judgment for rewards. Everybody clear on that? This is where you won't be. And if you don't know Jesus here, you don't want to be. This is where people have rejected God, small and great. Well, I'm not really that bad. So you're a small sinner. Small sins are enough to keep you out of heaven, just as much as big sins are able to keep you out of heaven, because the wages of sin is death. And this means separation from God. And so these people are judged according to their deeds. You will not be judged according to your deeds. For a grace are we saved through faith, and that not ourselves. It is a gift of God, not of works. Lest anyone should boast. Praise God, because my works aren't going to be looked over in the great white throne judgment. So is God just? Oh, yeah. Read the back of the book. God is just. And every single wicked person who thinks they've got away with something, it's there. The books are open and their names are not written in the book of life. That's sad. You trust in Jesus Christ. Your name is written in the book of life. Jesus has your name. Saved, 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 saved. You're there. Praise the Lord. The next thing that I want to contrast with these the pagan gods and these myths is there was no such thing as a loving God. The truth of the true and living God is that God loves us deeply. And most of the time we say, God loves us so much. I like the fact God loves us deeply. No pagan God loved any human being. If the word love was used, it would be eros, erotic love, sexual love. They didn't even love in a brotherly love kind of way. And in no way did they love in this Christian term, agape love, which is a selfish, sacrificial love. Never, never that. For God so loved the world. God loves the world, though. Pagan gods, they might reward you if you did something that they wanted you to do, but there was no concept of love. God loves you deeply. And I want you to look at Psalm 103, which will be, of course, to the left, pretty much middle-ish in your Bible. Psalm 103. David begins with this praise. Bless the Lord, O my soul, and all that is within me. Bless his holy name. Bless the Lord, all my soul, and forget none of his benefits, who forgives all your iniquities, who heals all your diseases, who redeems your life from the pit, and crowns you with steadfast love and mercy. Then look at verse 8. The Lord is merciful and gracious, slow to anger and abounding in deep love. That's what steadfast love, compassion, deep love. The Lord is merciful and gracious, slow to anger, abounding in steadfast love. He will not always chide. This means he will not constantly accuse us. Nor will he keep his anger forever. He does not deal with us according to our sins. Somebody say amen to that. Amen. Nor repay us according to our iniquities. For as high as the heavens are above the earth, so great is his steadfast love to those who fear him. As far as the east is from the west, so far does he remove our transgressions from us. As a father shows compassion to his children, so the Lord shows compassion to those who fear him, for he knows our frame. He remembers that we are dust. A couple of things. God knows your frame. God knows your frame. He knows how you're built. He knows how you think. He knows your struggles. My frame is not your frame. He knows your frame. You've messed up this week, or last week, or this month, or the last year. He knows your frame. He remembers you're just dust. You're not a God. He knows that. He understands that. Now, of course, God gives us power to change through the power of the Holy Spirit. And that's one of the things that happens in a Christian's life. But Christians aren't perfect, as everybody here knows it. And Christians hate their sins, as everybody here knows. And Christians, if they could, would push a button that would make us never sin again. We'd say, if that's the button, I'm pushing it right now. That makes us different from unsaved people. We hate our sin. But he knows our frame. He's not the God that is harsh, cruel, who cannot love, and who is, it says, constantly accusing. He will not always chide. And then the other thing that I want you to think about is verse 13. I remember it, memorized it this way. Just as a father shows compassion to his children, so the Lord shows compassion to those who fear him. Just as a father. Now, Leslie and I raised three awesome kids. I love them. We love them so much. And I can remember doing this with them. And now we have four grands. And I have done it with let's see, where do I start? Their order of birth. Let's just don't do it that way. I've done it with Riley and Ivy and Leela and Genesis. And I still do it. Till they're too big, I'll probably do it. Just as the Lord has compassion on his, just as a father has compassion on his children. What is that word, compassion? You'll never guess. It's the word for bouncing a child on your knee. Do you know that? Yes. It's the word for a father bouncing his little child on his knee. Just as a father would bounce the little child. You know, one of our pastors, they just had a little boy, and he was telling me, you know, sometimes I just stare into his little face, and I think, I helped create you. That just hit me. I thought, what a cool thought. But as God bounces us on his knee, God is thinking, I created you. I love you. If you love your children, how much more God loves you. It's sad that these people, that Paul and Barnabas went to minister to, did not have these concepts of God. They couldn't trust God because they created God in their own image. And they didn't know a God who loved them. But see, the greatest expression of God's love for us came through his Son, Jesus Christ. The Apostle John wrote in 1 John 4, he says, in this, the love of God was manifested, and it means once and for all, in that he gave his only son for us. The way God showed his ultimate love is by giving Jesus Christ to die for us. For God so loved the world that he what? Gave his only begotten son. He's the fullest expression of the God who, yes, wants you to be his child. And that happens when we pray and the Lord says, I'll receive you, but you've got to ask me to be your Savior. And I don't think that I need to, like, try to convince you that you need God. I don't think I need to do that. I don't need to convince you that you're not right with God or that you're not sure if you're going to heaven or not. I don't think I need to do that today. I just feel really like the Lord just wants me to offer you an invitation to give your life to him. Jesus will save you. You won't end up in that great white throne judgment that I was talking about. But rather, you're a child loved by a compassionate God that you can trust. The verse God put on my heart this week, thinking about you, was this. The verse in the Bible says, today, if you hear his voice, do not harden your heart. Today, if you hear his voice, do not harden your heart. You know how God tugs on you. You know how God's speaking to you. So I want to ask us to bow our heads. Go ahead, close your eyes so you don't have distractions around. And God's pulling on your heart. He's tugging on you. And this is what I want you to do. I want you to respond to God, because today, if you hear his voice, don't harden your heart. Rather, ask the Lord to save you. The Bible says, whoever will call upon the name of the Lord will be saved. And we just call by praying. And so I'm going to pray a prayer, a simple prayer, asking God to save. You pray it with me, phrase by phrase. But you mean it with all your heart. You don't have to pray it out loud, okay? But you just pray it with all your heart. And Jesus will save you. He will come into your life. Pray this prayer. Father in heaven, thank you for loving me and for sending Jesus to die for all the wrong things that I've done. I'm sorry for my sins. Please forgive me. I accept Jesus as my Savior. I want to be a new person. Give me a new life. It is a relief to ask you to be my Savior and my Lord. Keep your heads bowed, your eyes closed. If you prayed that prayer, this is what I want you to do. The Bible said that if we will acknowledge Jesus, he will acknowledge us before the Father and the angels who are in heaven. But he says if we don't acknowledge him, we basically don't mean business. Everybody that Jesus called to follow him that we know of in the Bible, he always called them openly and publicly, not in some secret little room where they could say yes and nobody know. He always said, he called them openly and publicly. You've prayed that prayer. You've prayed it. You believe it. Jesus is to save you. Your name is written in the book of life right now. Now, this is what I'm going to ask you to do, openly and publicly. I'm not going to ask you to come forward here and stand. Well, that would be open and public. I'm not going to ask you to stand up. That would, of course, be really super open, public. But what I want to do, these people are praying for you, okay? You got more people praying for you, I bet, than you ever had in your whole life. What I want you to do right now, you prayed that prayer, you mean business with God, I want you to raise your hand up, okay? I want you to raise your hand so I can see you. Your hand up, and keep your hands up, will you? I see you over here. I see you here in the second row, and I see you over here in the second row. I see you way back there. Keep your hands up. I see you here. I'm actually giving you something, or somebody's giving you something for me. So keep your hands up, okay? See you right here. Anybody else? And you're thinking, oh, I should raise my hand. I'm nervous. Oh, come on. Jesus wasn't nervous to save you when he died. Anybody else? Okay. I want to pray for you. Thank you, Lord, for these who have given their lives to you today. Pray that they'll walk with you in obedience, that they'll see more and more about this new life they have in you. In Jesus' name. Amen. We want to say welcome to God's family. Another page turned in the book of life, right? More names. More names. That's awesome. Now, we are going to be baptizing people, but you gave your life to Jesus. I'm saying this. Why don't you get baptized? Why don't you get baptized right now? The Bible, all throughout this book of Acts, we're reading, people believed and they were baptized. They believed and they were baptized. Why don't you get baptized? Baptism represents you believing that what Jesus died for you on the cross. He died, he was buried, he rose from the dead. What saves you is Jesus' death, his burial, and resurrection. And when you're baptized, you're saying not that you're good. You're saying, I'm hanging on to that cross. I believe Jesus died for me, and I'm hanging on to that as my only way of salvation. And he was buried, and I was buried with Jesus, and my sins have all been forgiven. And I've raised with Jesus, and he's never going to let go of me. That's what baptism is a picture of. So if you haven't been baptized, or maybe you didn't get saved today, but you never have, I want to give the opportunity. It's going to wreak havoc back there. You're going to say, what is going on? And then to complicate things more, you gave your life to Jesus as I prayed. I want you, as we sing, Pastor Jordan, we're going to all stand. I want you to just make your way up there to the door, the exit door. Somebody will open that, I think. And just head up there. We go. Pastor Bill's here. Just you make your way up there. We want to pray with you, okay? So let's all stand. And you guys go wherever you need. Oh, if you're going to be baptized, go out those back doors, okay? See the north west door and down the hall, and there'll be somebody ready to flag you down. Okay, so here we go. Let's just make the big move, okay?
My chains are gone, I've been set free. My God, my Savior has ransomed me. And like a flood, his mercy reigns, unending love, amazing grace.
Let's sing it out. My chains are gone.
Chains are gone, I've been set free. My God, my Savior has ransomed me. And like a flood, his mercy reigns, unending love, amazing grace.
Amen. Man, please be seated.
God, we just thank you as we continue to worship. And we're reminded in Romans, it says that God demonstrated his love for us, that yet while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. That's our story, Lord. We thank you so much that it's from a well of gratitude that we pour out praises to the name of the Lord on high. We just thank you, Lord. In your name we pray, amen. As we continue to worship, our ushers are coming forward to present our gifts and offerings.
Forevermore, forevermore. Son of Heaven rose again. Oh, trampled death, where is your sting? The angels roar for Christ the King.
Let's all stand together.
Oh, praise the the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now I'm found. Was blind, but now I see. Was blind, but now I see. Amen. Let's give him praise this morning. Amen. Please be seated.
This is Grace. Hi, Grace.
Hi. How are you?
I'm doing great. I'm very excited today.
Me too.
I know. When was it that the Lord saved you?
It's been a couple years, but this was the time where I wanted to become fully Christian, and he showed me the way, and I'm here. This is it. This is the day.
This is the day, and you're not ashamed of the Lord and to show the whole world.
Yes, I'm here to say I believe in Jesus, and he's my Lord. Amen.
Okay, I want to point them out. Now, you have friends and family here. Would you stand up?
My son, my little one there. And my friends, they're all in that lined up.
Oh, they're right there, the whole line. And your son was so quiet, and he was listening the whole time. I was impressed. I really was. Well, let's pray. Lord, we thank you so much for Grace. We ask that you will bless her as she continues her walk with you. I'm glad that she is sensitive to your Holy Spirit's voice. We thank you for friends and family who have surrounded her and support her in her spiritual walk. I ask that the Holy Spirit would just come upon her in fresh power now. In Jesus' name, amen.
Thank you.
Yeah, I've been. We lost our translator, a Spanish translator, and so I was praying yesterday and the day before, Lord, what are we going to do here? And she says, the Lord just put on my heart that I want to Spanish this, translate this service into Spanish each week. And we'll, hey. This is Gladdy. Hi, Gladdy. When was it that Jesus saved you?
Long time ago.
A long time ago, and today is the day that you want to follow him in baptism, yes?
Yes.
Do you have friends here? Any family?
Yes.
Yes? Mom and friends, would you stand up? Oh, look at them out there. You see them waving their hands way out there?
I can see.
Oh, I see. Understand. Stephen behind us. All right. Lord, we pray right now for Gladdy that you will bless her as she continues her walk with you. We're so grateful that your Holy Spirit intervenes in our lives and leads us to Jesus. And I ask that you'll continue to fill Gladdy with your Spirit, that she'll find encouragement and comfort in you every single day as she walks her life with you. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. It's a joy for us to baptize you in Jesus' name, in the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Hi, this is Karen. This is your family in Christ. It's a lot of them, huh?
Yes, there is.
Hey, Karen, when did the Lord save you?
Many, many years ago.
Many years ago. And so this time you're just deciding, hey, I want to be baptized. It's time.
It's time.
All right. I agree. It's just good for us to step forward and do that step of obedience. Do you have friends or family here?
Husband and my other brother.
Say that again so we can hear you.
My brother, my sister-in-law, my daughter, my husband, and my other brother.
Oh, that is fantastic. That's great to have that kind of family support. We want to pray for you. Father, we thank you for our sister, for Karen, for her life. She's walked with you and she has followed you. And this step of obedience, I know, pleases you. You're just smiling right now. And we ask that the joy of the Holy Spirit will fill her and her family as well. In Jesus' name, amen. This is Griffin. Hey, Griffin, when did the Lord save you?
Early in childhood, but today I decided it's going to be the day that I come out public and say, Jesus is my Lord and Savior.
So you were somebody sitting there, and it was like God said, okay, son, now's the time.
Yes. Oh, amen, brother.
Amen. So when did the Lord save you? I'm just interested.
Early on, about 16, when I got out of trouble and turned my life around.
All right. That's great. That's great. Well, we're so glad to have us you as our brother in Christ. Do you have family out here and friends that are with you?
I have my girlfriend here.
Yeah. All right. You got more friends over here. Fantastic. Father, we thank you for our brother here who has instantly obeyed you. When you called him, he got up. And thank you for his faith. Thank you that he's listening to the Holy Spirit. My prayer is that you will lead him and his steps. You say that the steps of a righteous man are guided by the Lord, and I pray that every step he takes would be ordered by you. Pray that your plans for him would become clear, that he would follow you, become a godly man, a leader among your people and in your church. In Jesus' name, amen.
It's a joy to baptize you in Jesus' name, in the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.
This is my baby boy, Christian. Yeah, I'm so proud of him. You know, he decided to take this leap, and I could just see God in his life just moving. And he's got a good heart. You know, I'm probably gonna embarrass him just a little bit here, so I'll probably pay for this later. But I'd say, last week I had a late dinner that I had, and I was working late. And I usually tuck his sister and him, you know, I pray for him every night. And I found out later that he actually went into his sister's room and tucked her in and prayed for her. I'm just so proud. He's got a good heart. And so I just wanted to brag on him a little bit, but I'll let you take it.
Well, there's nothing like baptizing your son. Lord, I thank you so much for this family. We all love them, this whole family. We thank you for the leadership that they have provided for us. And we're so thankful for Christian and for his the life that you have given to him, that he is listening to you, that he wants to follow you, that his heart is sensitive to you. And we're asking, Lord, that you will fill him with your Holy Spirit, guide him, protect his walk. Don't let anything pull him to the right or to the left of what you have for him, and make that very clear. Thank you for saving him by your loving grace. In Jesus' name.
So this is my sister-in-law, Selena, and my brother-in-law, Carlos. Yeah, I'm just so proud of these two, too. They've got amazing two kids that they're raising right now, and just wonderful examples of the Lord, and they're growing so much. And I would really like, do you want to maybe take over the interview here for them? I just want to hear their...
Oh, sure.
Yeah, I just want to introduce them.
Hey, Carlos. I see your tears. I'm ready to cry with this whole family. It's like, I can't believe what God is doing. So when did the Lord save you, Carlos?
About 7-8 years ago, me and Joe were actually playing basketball together. And, you know, we started talking. He opened up a conversation, and we took a knee down. And I was overfilled with emotion more than I thought I would be, to be honest. And, you know, just, you know, things throughout my life pointed me in this direction. And then my father passing away, his 1 year coming up this end of May. And I just, you know, wanted to keep my faith and come closer. And everything was pointing in this direction. So, amen.
Jesus saved you. Amen. Hey, Selena.
Hi.
Hi. When did the Lord save you?
Well, I felt the bigger bond come more in the last year when Carlos and I took our relationship into a marriage, and we've really worked harder for our relationship. And otherwise, I've just been waiting for this moment to come back again, a reason to really get closer.
A Christian family. It's pretty awesome, isn't it? So happy for you guys. Well, who's going to be baptized first? You, so that, I know ladies first, but this way you can stand and drip for a minute, okay? So why don't you stand right over there where you can see well.
Up in prayer. Father God, thank you so much for your love and your grace that you give us every day, Lord. And I'm just so grateful for the family we have here, and these two especially, Lord. I just pray that your spirit lead and guide them, Lord. I pray that you protect them, Father God. You lay out the plan that you have set before them, Lord, that they be an example of you to everybody they come in contact with, Lord, and other family members, and that they are able to lead their children, Lord, and show them the right path. And I just pray that special protection upon them, Lord, in Jesus' name.
It's a joy for us to baptize you in Jesus' name, in the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Baptize you, my brother, in Jesus' name, in the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
You know, everyone, we're kind of gone over here. If you guys got little ones, go ahead and pick them up, and they're welcome to come back in and be a part of this. This is a big deal. So,
yeah, how many more people are being baptized? 10 more. All right. So, hey, that's worth some to come back. So come back. Bring the kiddos. Let them see what happens, okay, to believers in big church. You guys okay? 10 more? You cool with that? All right.
I got another family member here. He's like a second father to me. This is Jim, my father-in-law. And I have to say, you know, for the last 20 years, just the love and the grace and you know, your patience, and you know, you've been a good example as a father, really, you really have. And I'm just so proud of you. I'm so glad you're here taking this big public statement of your Appreciate faith in Christ. So I'm excited about that. Jim, do you want to, sorry, Pastor Mark, do you want to interview him? I just want to introduce him. Or do you want to just...
When did you accept the Lord?
There you go. When did you accept the Lord?
Pretty much just recently, just in the other room.
Yeah.
I mean, I've been in the church for a while, and I made that decision to make that new step.
So the Lord maybe really made this clear to you mm-hmm. today.
Yes.
That's what we're hearing.
Mm-hmm. That's what we got. Thanks. Excellent.
You're the guy I was praying for this week. Yes. That's so cool. Hey.
Father God, what an exciting day. What a celebration today, Lord. We're just so grateful that, Jim, the angels are praising right now and rejoicing, Lord, and all these people coming to you, Jesus. And I just pray for Jim, Lord, that your spirit will lead and guide him, Lord, and reveal your love for him at a level that he hasn't experienced, Lord. I just pray and will lead and guide his steps, and that you will draw him in closer, Lord, that if there's any kind of veil that's been over his eyes over these years, whatever, just reveal the, lift the veil, Lord, and let him see clearly you. And I just pray he projects, and he already, Lord, shows that love that you have as a father figure, Lord. And I just pray that now he can be that even deeper leader, Lord, a man of God. And I just pray that upon him in Jesus' name.
Great, I'm doing good. This is Sean and this is Tori. Want to welcome them, okay? So, Tori, when was it that the Lord saved you?
Well, I've grown up being a Christian and I just think it's time that I get baptized and wash away my sins and be born again in Christ.
Amen. How about you? How about you, Sean?
I was saved earlier this year. I've just been through a lot of trials and tribulations recently, and I know that me or my wife, Tori, here, wouldn't have gotten through it without Jesus. And I just want to give God all the glory.
Amen. Amen. Well, he is the one who holds our lives together, isn't he? For sure. I'm so glad that our sins are forgiven and that we come here, rejoicing what Jesus did. Amen. Well, I did this backwards last time, so I'll baptize you first. Okay, is that right? I got the right, but we want to pray first. I'm just wanting you to know it's going to be done right this time. Father, we thank you so much for this couple and for your saving work, that it was not according to deeds of righteousness that they have done that have saved them, but it's through your grace and your love and mercy. We're asking, Father, please, that you will pour out your spirit in a special way on Sean as a man, as a leader, as a Christian man, and that you will show him his place in the bigger picture of the church, your body, where he serves, where you want him to be. Pray that your spirit would be strong on him, Lord. Protect him from the tug of sin and the things that can bring him down. Give him courage in his heart, Lord. Heal him where he hurts, we ask. And we're thankful so much for our sister Tori, and we ask that you will bless her. Thank you for her obedience, for her listening to the Spirit and saying, today's the day, and I want to obey you. Pour out your grace and your spirit on her as well, we pray. Give her wisdom. Make her just wise beyond her years. And we pray that as you do that, she will be able to share your grace and love with others in the future. In Jesus' name, amen.
It's a joy for us to baptize you as well, in Jesus' name.
Guys, this is Parker. Give him a big welcome, okay? Is this cross new for today?
No, it's actually, I've been wearing it for like 2 years already, but it's like, helps me, keeps me safe and everything.
You believe that Jesus in his work on the cross has saved you, right? Yeah, right. Nothing in that saves you or keeps you safe, but it's the holy angels around you, you know? And I see it as a proclamation that you're not ashamed to be a Christian either, right? Not at all. How old are you?
I'm 18.
You're 18. Okay, what do you have your sights set on in the years to come here?
Probably becoming a pastor myself. I want to share the gospel to everyone and help everyone right now. And yeah.
Well, maybe we can help you out there, okay? Hey, that's fantastic. Yeah. Lord, thank you so much for Parker, for his family, his friends. And I'm asking, Lord, that your hand would continue to be upon him, that you'll teach him your ways. You've given him a heart, he wants to be a pastor. We ask that you would open those doors for him. Pray that you'll give him the power of your Holy Spirit, strength, that where he feels weak, you'd make him strong. Build him up, Lord, in the Holy Spirit and in your power, in Jesus' name. Now, Parker, before you leave, you got friends and family out there. Where are you guys?
Right in the front.
Right on the front. Awesome.
Pretty good guy.
All right.
Well, this is Mary Lou. Mary Lou, when did the Lord save you?
A junior in high school.
Junior high school. And you have friends and family out here?
I do. I have quite a few.
Quite a few. Look at them out there. We see you. So if somebody is thinking about Jesus and giving their life to Jesus, what... You've known the Lord for a while now. What would you tell them?
Oh my gosh, read your Bible. It just makes such a huge difference.
You're going to find out about the Lord there in the Bible, aren't you? Amen. We want to pray for you. Lord, we thank you so much, all of us as a church family, for Mary Lou. We are happy for her today. We're rejoicing with her in this significant time where she is taking this step up and she's saying, I'm not ashamed of Jesus, never have been, but I want to make a public commitment. I want to do what Jesus said. And we are happy for that right now. Continue to guide her, Lord, as you have now for many years. May she experience your power and your joy in ways that she never thought she could. In Jesus' name, amen. I was telling Gene, you stand in this line long enough and you become friends. They were just like new friends there when Mary Lou was coming up the steps. So, Gene, obviously I just introduced you. When did the Lord save you?
When I was 40.
You were 40. And how did that happen? Were you at a church or friend?
It was in my backyard with a teacher from a Christian daycare that my kids were going to.
You're kidding me.
Yep.
How neat. Just out there sharing Jesus, huh?
Yeah.
And I can imagine by hearing you and looking at you, Jesus made a big change in your life.
Oh, gosh, yes. Yes, yes.
So if there's somebody sitting in the backyard with somebody who knows Jesus, what would you tell them they better do, huh?
Get saved.
Give their life to Jesus.
Give their life to Jesus. Peace and joy.
You should be an advertisement for Jesus. Amen. You have friends and family out here?
I do.
Where are you guys?
I have my daughter and my grandson.
All right.
And today is our 40th wedding anniversary.
Today is your 40th wedding anniversary.
Sense of humor.
Yeah, it is. That's amazing. That's cool.
I guess I'm going to pray for
you. Please do.
Lord, we thank you for our sister. We're glad for the work that you have done in her life. We thank you for the joy of the Holy Spirit that fills her. Lord, the compassion that she has to be a ready friend. We thank you that you saved her by your grace. After living a long time, you said, I'm not going to let her go. I'm going to choose her. I'm going to make her my child. And we're just so glad that you did that. We ask that you continue, Lord, to fill her with the Holy Spirit's power, to show her where she fits in to the body of Christ, to the church. Use her gifts. And Lord, again, we are just so glad you save us by grace, through faith, not of our works. We would never boast except in Jesus, your Son. This is Lydia. Say hi to Lydia. Lydia, when did the Lord save you?
No, it's been about 20 years ago.
20 years
yeah.
ago.
Mm-hmm.
And how was that?
Uplifting.
Uh-huh. How did it happen? Did somebody share? Did you
just
hear?
Church and people sharing, and I know this is the way.
Uh-huh.
This is the way.
And your life has been changed by Christ.
Yeah.
You know, walking with him, that's amazing. And to see, you know, I know there's other believers that have not been baptized. They've just been waiting and waiting for something. But I know you're here, and you would say, you would encourage them to be baptized, right?
Absolutely, yes. I mean, I was baptized as a child when mm-hmm. I was a kid, I mean, mm-hmm. baby. Mm-hmm. But I know I need this for my salvation.
Amen. Well, not for our salvation, but as a picture of our salvation. Yes. Amen. Amen. Well, we want to pray for you. Lord, we are grateful for our sister, for the love that you showed to her. We just give you all praise and glory and honor. You're a worthy, worthy, worthy Savior. Thank you for changed lives. And we ask that Lydia would just be continually filled with your strength and your power as you use her in her walk and her life. In Jesus' name, amen. This is Trish, and she loves Jesus and wants to be baptized. Amen.
That's great.
Father, we all want to join together in prayer right now for our sister. Just being able to see her and see one of the trophies of your grace is fantastic. And we would ask again, blessing on her. That your Holy Spirit's power would fall freshly on her, and she would find encouragement and joy in every day, and she'd be obedient, following you, just as she is right now. In Jesus' name, amen. Your name is?
Sammy.
Simon. A few. Hey, why don't you guys stand up? You know this man. All right. Right on. They love you, huh? So it seems like it, right? So when did you accept Jesus?
Around high school years. Uh-huh. Don't have an exact date for you.
Yeah, that's okay. I don't either. So you've seen the Lord just kind of slowly working in your life?
Yeah, of course, especially when I started attending Calvary this past year. I started growing as a community, meeting all my friends that are up here.
Yeah. So you go Thursday night to community, right? You're going there every week, and you're finding you really grow there, huh?
Yeah, of course.
That's great.
It really helps.
All right. That's sweet. Well, if somebody your age, how old are you?
I'm 25.
Okay, 25. I got a 25-year person out here, or they're watching online. We got to remember, we got people watching. And they're looking and they're saying, really, Jesus, should I, shouldn't I? What would you say? Not a lot of theology, but what would you say? They're in that place.
Honestly, I don't know what to say. But throughout my life, I just felt like I was lost. But the more I started getting involved in the church, I started feeling more loved and more part of a family and the community.
And you found out how much Jesus loved you, right? Amen. And you know what? You say you don't know what to say, but you just said everything you need to say, man. Thank you for Simon. We ask your blessing on Simon, that he'll continue to walk. Sammy. I'm sorry. And and Sammy, that he would be specially blessed by you, your Holy Spirit poured out upon him. In Jesus' name, amen. I laugh sometimes because Joe does the hard work. Joseph takes the people down, but he almost hits their head on the bottom. He takes them down so low. I smile sometimes. That's what you see afterwards. Or I'll kind of laugh. It's because I thought, I don't know. They know they're baptized. If he's got a part of it, for sure. It's the whole experience. Well, let's stand up. I want to ask God's blessing on you. Isn't it exciting to see? I mean, full circle, you know, you see people saved, baptized, growing in Jesus. This is what it's all about, our whole life in Christ. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. And may the Lord lift up his countenance on you. That means smile on you. And give you his peace and his special protection is my prayer for you in Jesus' name. And everybody said, turn around and say, have a great week to somebody.